asked our respected principal, sir. Then I will welcome our head of the department, Professor M. M. Mojumdar, sir, and all the respected faculty members of this department. And last but not the least, our beloved students who have joined this meeting to grace the students' seminar by Physics Department on this day, May 21, 2021, I welcome all of them. The students who will be speaking in this seminar and also the students who are there to listen to the speakers. We are privileged that Principal Sir has given us the valuable time. Now, I request our Principal Sir to deliver few words regarding this seminar. Principal Sir, please.
Good morning, respected my colleagues and my beloved students. I am very glad to present here to listen to seminar which is delivered by the students. It is a good opportunity of the students to represent themselves as a speaker. This type of initiative will be better for development of his or her future as they face in future time in different interviews. This type of initiative helps them to represent themselves in the form of large number of people. I hope this seminar will be success very much. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot. Now I request our respected HOD, sir, to deliver his encouraging speech towards the students and also towards all of us. So, to the proceedings of the seminar now. And Ed, sir, please deliver your little speech to encourage the students, sir.
Respected principal, sir, respected senior teacher of our department, what is supportive, my dear departmental colleagues, and my dear beloved students of this department. I thank all of you to make this student seminar to be successful, I suppose. With the inspiration of this principle, the untiring effort of our senior teacher, KC sir, and our two colleagues, TA sir, Tirtha Gautam sir, and Uday sir, Hindi sir, Uday Das sir, they have taken a lot of hard jobs, done a lot of hard jobs to make this one day seminar to be delivered by the students a reality. I thank once again all of you, particularly our two young teachers from the bottom of my heart, for their untiring efforts to make this a success. For the students, I say that this is a great opportunity to express yourself in the bigger platform, because in front of the teachers and the other students of our department, the physics that you have nurtured so far, this will help, or this will serve as a springboard for your future destination. Because as you see, our principles are saying here that whenever you face a product in higher institutions of repute, you face such, you have to present yourself the physics that you have learned so far. On the other hand, it is also a test for our teachers to assess ourselves that what sort of teaching we have imparted. So, from just that perspective also, the teachers are very fortunate to assess themselves from this meeting or from this seminar. This is the today's seminar will be delivered by the students of six semester students. But in the next 2 weeks, we'll arrange again the seminars of this this type to be delivered by fourth semester and second semester students also for their betterment. I beg your pardon for my low voice, as you know that I am suffering from from something else. So that I am just serving as a spectator for this, specially to conduct the seminar, so far as the conductor of this seminar is concerned. With these few words, I wish this seminar to be a very grand success, and thank you all.
Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot. Thanks for your encouraging speech. Now, for this unprecedented COVID situation, we have to conduct this seminar via Google Meet platform. Each and every one of us is probably missing our class atmosphere and our whole college in general. However, we are heartily trying to make up that feeling by taking this initiative of organizing an online seminar. Hope you all will enjoy this as much as we did hosting it. Students, now I will ask you one by one to deliver your speech. At first, I will ask Dev Goipanan Haldar to deliver his speech on Big Bang Theory. Dev Goipanan?
Yes, sir. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning, sir.
Yeah. Good morning, everyone. I am Dev Goipanan Haldar. Today, I am going to discuss on the Big Bang Theory. So, without wasting any time, let's begin. You know, Albert Einstein said, two things are infinite, the universe and the human stupid. And I am not sure about the universe. Universe. The more we learn about it, the more questions seem to arise in our mind. Such as, how was our universe created? How did it come to be the seemingly infinite place we know of today? And what will become of it ages from now? From where the journey of time began? These are the questions that have been puzzling philosophers and scholars also since the beginning of the human civilization and led to some pretty wild and interesting truths. Today, the consensus among scientists, astronomers, and cosmologists in that the universe as we know it was created in a massive explosion that not only created the majority of matter, but the physical laws that govern our ever-expanding cosmos. This is known as the Big Bang Theory, the most accepted theory of our origin. The basics of the theory are fairly simple. In short, the Big Bang hypothesis states that all of the current and past matter in the universe came into existence at the same time, roughly 13.8 billion years ago. At this time, all matter was compacted into a very small ball with infinite density and intensity called a singularity. Suddenly, the singularity began expanding and the universe we know it began. While this is not the only modern theory of how universe came into being, for example, there is the steady state theory or the oscillating universe theory, but it is the most widely accepted and popular. Not only does the model explain the origin of all known matter, the laws of physics, and the large scale structure of the universe, it also accounts the expansion of the universe and a broad range of other phenomena. Let's see the historical background of the theory. The earliest indication of the Big Bang occurred as a result of deep space observations conducted in the early 20th century. In 1912, American astronomer Vesto Slipper conducted a series of observations of spiral galaxies and measured their Doppler redshift. In almost all cases, the spiral galaxies were observed to be moving away from our own. In 1922, Russian cosmologist Alexander Friedman developed what are known as the Friedman equations, which were derived from Einstein's equations for general relativity. Friedman's work showed that the universe was likely in a state of expansion. Now in 1924, Edwin Hubble's measurement of the great distance to the nearest spiral nebula showed that these systems were indeed other galaxies. At the same time, Hubble began developing a series of distance indicators using the 100-inch Hooker telescope at Mount Wilson Observatory. And by 1929, Hubble discovered a correlation between distance and recession velocity, which is now known as Hubble's law. And then in 1927, Georges Lemaître, a Belgian physicist and Roman Catholic priest, independently derived the same result as Friedman's equation and proposed that the infrared recession of the galaxies were due to the expansion of the universe. In 1931, he took this further, suggesting that the current expansion of the universe means that the farther back in time one went, the smaller the universe would be. At some point in the past, he argued the entire mass of the universe would have been concentrated into a single point from which the very fabric of space and time originated. These discoveries triggered a debate between physicists throughout the 1920s and 30s, with the majority advocating that the universe was in a steady state. Among these scientists, the idea of a Big Bang seemed to be more theoretical than scientific. After World War II, the debate came to a head between proponents of the steady state model, which was given by Fred Hoyle, and proponents of the Big Bang theory, which was growing in popularity. Eventually, the observational evidence began to favor Big Bang over steady state. The discovery and confirmation of the cosmic microwave background radiation in 1965 secured the Big Bang as the best theory of the origin and evolution of the universe. Later, Stephen Hawking and other physicists showed that singularities were an inevitable initial condition of general relativity and a Big Bang model of the cosmology. Now, let's talk on the timeline of the Big Bang. Working backwards from the current state of universe, scientists have theorized that it must have originated at a single point of infinite density and finite time that began to expand. After the initial expansion, the theory maintains the universe cooled sufficiently to allow the formation of subatomic particles and later simple atoms. Giant clouds of these primordial elements later coalesced through gravity to form stars and galaxies. This all began roughly 13.8 billion years ago and is thus considered to be the age of the universe. Through the testing of theoretical principles, experiments involving particle accelerator and high energy states, the astronomical studies that have observed the deep universe, scientists have constructed a timeline of events that began with the Big Bang and has led to the current state of the cosmic evolution. However, the earliest time of the universe, lasting from approximately 10⁻⁴3 to 10⁻¹ⁱ seconds after the Big Bang, are the subject of extensive speculation. Given that the laws of physics as we know them would not have existed at this time, it is difficult to fathom how the universe would have been governed. Now let us discuss the theory stepwise. Firstly, the singularity, which is also known as the Planck epoch or the Planck era. This was the earliest known period of the universe. At this time, all matter was condensed on a single point of infinite density and extreme heat. During this period, it is believed that the quantum effect of gravity dominated physical interactions and that no other physical forces were of equal strength to gravitation. This Planck period of time extends from point zero to approximately 10⁻³ seconds and is so named because it can only be measured in Planck time. Due to the extreme heat and density of matter, the state of the universe was highly unstable. It thus began to expand and cool, leading to the magnification of the fundamental forces of physics. From approximately 10⁻⁴ seconds and 10⁻⁳, the universe began to cross transition temperatures. It is here that the fundamental forces that govern the universe are believed to have begun separating from each other. the first step in this was the force of gravitation separating from gauge forces, which account for strong and weak nuclear forces and electromagnetism. Then from 10 to the power minus 36 to 10 to the power minus 32 seconds after the Big Bang, the temperature of the universe was low enough, nearly 10 to the power 28 Kelvin, that the forces of electromagnetism and weak nuclear force were able to separate as well, forming two distinct forces. Now the second point, which is the inflation epoch. With the creation of the first fundamental forces of the universe, the inflation epoch began, lasting from 10 to the power minus 32 seconds in Planck time to an unknown point. Most cosmological models suggest that the universe at this point was filled homogeneously with a high energy density, and that the incredibly high temperatures and pressure gave rise to rapid expansion and cooling. This began at 10 to the power minus 37 seconds, where the phase transition that caused for the separation of forces also led to a period where the universe grew exponentially. It was also this point in the time that baryogenesis occurred, which refers to a hypothetical event where temperatures were so high that random motions of the particles occurred at a relativistic speed. As a result of this, particle-antiparticle pairs of all kinds were being continuously created and destroyed in the collisions, which is believed to have led to predominance of matter over antimatter in the present universe. After inflation stopped, the universe consisted of a quark-gluon plasma as well as other elementary particles. From this point onward, the universe began to cool and matter coalesced and formed. Now coming to the next point, the cooling epoch. As the universe continued to decrease in density and temperature, the energy of each particle began to decrease, and phase transition continued until the fundamental forces of physics and elementary particles changed to their present form. Since particle energies would have dropped to values that can be obtained by particle physics experiment, this period onward is subject to less speculation. Since temperature were not high enough to create new proton-antiproton pairs, mass annihilation immediately followed, leaving just 1 in 10 to the power 10 of the original protons and neutrons and none of their antiparticles. A similar process happened at about 1 second after the Big Bang for electrons and positrons. After this annihilation, the remaining protons, neutrons and electrons were no longer moving relativistically, and the energy density of the universe was dominated by protons and, to a lesser extent, neutrinos. A few minutes into the expansion, the period known as Big Bang nucleosynthesis also began. Thanks to temperature dropping to 1 billion Kelvin and the energy densities dropping to about the equivalent of air, neutrons and protons began to combine to form the universe's first deuterium and helium atoms. However, the most of the universe protons remained uncombined as hydrogen nuclei. After about 379,000 years, electrons combined with this nuclei to form atoms, while the radiation decoupled from matter and continued to expand through space, largely unimpeded. The radiation is now known to be what constitutes the cosmic microwave background, or generally known as CMB, which today is the oldest light in the universe. Now the next epoch, that is the structure epoch. Over the course of several billion years that followed, the slightly denser regions of the almost uniformly distributed matter of the universe began to become gravitationally attracted to each other. They therefore grew very denser, forming gas clouds, stars, galaxies, and the other astronomical structures that we regularly observe today. This is what is known as structure epoch, since it was during this time that the modern universe began to take shape. This consists of visible matter distributed in structures of various sizes, ranging from stars and planets to galaxies, galaxy clusters and superclusters, where matter is concentrated that are separated by enormous gulfs containing few galaxies. The details of this process depend on the amount of type of matter in the universe, with cold dark matter, warm dark matter, hot dark matter and baryonic matter being the fourth suggested type. However, the lambda cold dark matter model, or popularly known as lambda CDM model, in which the dark matter particles move slowly compared to the speed of light, it considered to be the standard model of Big Bang cosmology, as it best fits the available data. The lambda refers to the cosmological constant, a theory originally proposed by Albert Einstein that attempted to show that the balance of mass energy in the universe was static. Now, let's talk about the most interesting part of this theory, the long-term predictions of this theory. Now, hypothesizing that the universe had a starting point naturally gives rise to question about a possible endpoint. If the universe began as a tiny point of infinite density that started to expand, does that mean it will continue to expand indefinitely? Or will it one day run out of expansive force and being retarded inward until all matter crunches back into a tiny ball? Answering these questions has been a major focus of cosmologists ever since the debate about which model of the universe was the correct one began. With the acceptance of the Big Bang theory, but prior to the observation on dark energy in 1990s, cosmologists had come to agree on two scenarios as being the most likely outcomes for our universe. In the first, commonly known as the Big Crunch scenario, the universe will reach a maximum size and then begin to collapse in on itself. This will be possible if the mass density of the universe is greater than the critical density. In other words, as long as the density of the matter remains at or above a certain value, that is 1 to 3 into 10 to the power minus 26 kg of matter per cubic meter, the universe will eventually contract. Alternatively, if the density in the universe were equal to or below the critical density, the expansion would be slowed down but never stop. In this scenario, known as the Big Freeze, the universe would go on until star formation eventually ceased with the consumption of all the interstellar gas in each galaxy. Meanwhile, all existing stars would burn out and become white dwarfs, neutral stars, and black holes. Very gradually, collisions between these black holes would result in mass accumulating into larger and larger black holes. The average temperature of the universe would approach absolute zero, and black holes would evaporate after emitting the last of their Hawking radiation. Finally, the entropy of the universe would increase to a point where no organized form of energy could be extracted from it. This scenario is known as the heat death of the universe. Now, modern observations, which include the existence of dark energy and its influence on cosmic expansion, have led to the conclusion that more and more of the currently visible universe will pass beyond our event horizon and become invisible to us. The eventual result of this is not currently known, but heat death is considered a likely endpoint in this scenario too. Other explanations of dark energy, called phantom energy theories, suggest that ultimately galaxy clusters, stars, planets, atoms, nuclei, and matter itself will be torn apart by the ever increasing expansion. This scenario is known as the Big Rip, in which the expansion of the universe itself will eventually be its underground. That's all. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Debdulpan. It was a nice speech. Now, following Big Bang theory, our universe is still expanding. Like that, I think we should expand our mind to reach the other people in this tough situation. Okay, now, is there any questions from the audience to Debdulpan? Clear up anything?
May I ask two short questions to Debdulpan?
Yes,
may I ask two short questions to the chair?
Yeah, sure, sir. Sir, please.
So, there's one in your lecture, you have mentioned one thing, that's Planck's time. May I know that what is the order of this Planck's time?
Sir, it will obviously be very small, but I can. But I don't know what is the actual time.
Regarding the CMB, cosmic microwave background radiation. Now, what is the present status? Is it isotropic in nature, or what is the temperature of this microwave background radiation today?
Sorry, sir, I don't know.
It's a carry on, please.
Okay, thank you, Debdulpan. The speech was really nice. And thank you, sir. for your involvement, sir. We know you are always there. Okay, now.
As a science spectator.
We know from corpuscular theory of light, we know that light is made up of very tiny particles called photons. Now, there is a question. How is a light photon affected by gravity? No, I am not going to discuss about this. This will be discussed by Orijit. Orijit De, our next speaker. Orijit, now the,
yes,
not the stage, but screen is all yours.
Am I audible?
You are absolutely audible. It's fine. Audio.
Of Hooghly Moshing College, and my topic of discussion will be how a light photon is affected by gravity. So let's start it. Since our childhood, we all have seen that whenever we throw a body of mass m in upward direction, let's say with an initial velocity u, so after some time it reaches an amount of high h, and again it falls back to the ground. So if we clearly see what is happening here, we will see that at the moment of throwing the particle, we will see that the kinetic energy of the body will be maximum and the potential energy will be minimum. And when it reaches an amount of high h, so the kinetic energy will be minimum and the potential energy will be maximum. So in simple words, what we can say is that under the gravitational pull, the body, when it is going away from the ground, so it is actually losing some velocity. But what is the reason behind it? We all know that the body has some kind of mass m, so that is why for the gravitational pull it is happening. But what if we replace this body with that of a photon? Well, the photon, in the other hand, do not have any kind of rest mass, but they have some kind of energy. And from the Einstein's mass energy equivalence principle, we know that E equals mc square. So we can conclude that if something has an energy E, so it will have a mass associated with that E energy. Similarly, if a photon has an energy E, so it will have an effective mass m dashed, such that E equals m dash c square. So from this equation, we can say that the m dash or the effective mass of the photon can be E by c square. Let's take this matter in a celestial manner. Suppose it is a star of mass capital M and of radius r. And from its surface, light or a photon is emitting, and it's actually going at a distance infinity, where the gravitational pull by the star is actually zero, we can say. So if we clearly observe the total energy at different points, so at the surface of the star, what will the total energy of the photon? It's the radiant energy plus the potential energy, that is h nu minus g capital N m dash by r. Okay. Now, at a distance of infinity, what will be the total energy? We all know at a distance of infinity, as the gravitational pull by the star is zero in case of the photon, so the potential energy of the photon will be zero, but there some kind of radiant energy must exist. So that is h nu dashed. Here I have changed the frequency of the photon because some kind of work must be done against the gravitational pull in order to overcome that. Okay. So again, we know from the energy conservation law that the total energy must be conserved. So if we put the values of the energies of photon at the surface and at the infinity distance, so we will end up getting this equation. Okay, and further, if we simplify, we will get that there is a decrease in frequency, and is actually represented by capital G, capital M, M dash by Rh. And from the previous equation, we have seen that M dash equals E by C squared. And if we put the value of E as H nu, so what we will get? We will get the effective mass of photon as this. And let's put this here, and we will get the change in fractional change in frequency of a photon is this much. So what we can see from this equation is that as the light or photon is actually going away from the star, we can see from this expression that the frequency is decreasing, or we can say the wavelength is increasing. And if we consider the case of visible light, so the frequency will be shifting towards the red end of the spectrum, and this is called as gravitational redshift. So let's see some examples. First one, what will be the value of this fractional frequency, fractional change of frequency? It will be around 2.13 into 10 to the minus 6. So obviously this number is not huge enough and quite negligible. But if we consider in the case of neutron star, if we place the values of M, that is twice of that of the sun, and if we place the value of R, so we will end up getting a value which is larger than that of sun. So we can see there is an observable change in frequency of a photon which is actually away from a neutron star. And in case of a black hole, we all know that the black hole is very massive and its radius is comparatively low. So the fractional change in frequency will be much higher in the case of black hole. But I'm here considering that the photon will be passing out from the outside of the event horizon. But what if the photon gets any contact with that of the inside region of the event horizon? We all know that what will be the result? That the result will be the photon or the light will get sucked by the black hole. But what is the reason? Let's see. We know from the expression of the escape velocity that G equals root over 2gm by r. And for the black hole, m is very, very much large and r is very much low. And that will make such a value of escape velocity which will be greater than that of the velocity of light. And for this, when light gets contact inside the event horizon, so it will eventually get sucked by the black hole. So if we consider what can be the region of the event horizon and what can be the range of it, so we can represent it by a radius that is called Schwarzschild radius, that is named after the scientist Carl Schwarzschild in 1970. It is basically nothing, just here in the escape velocity expression, just put the minimum velocity of escape velocity right. At least on that in the case is that this kind of equation. So from this we can say that under this region, which is a radius, okay, so the region which has a radius of 2gm by c squared, so under this, if light or any particle which has a velocity of light is actually passing or actually going in the event horizon, so it will eventually get sucked. So from this formula, what we can conclude is that if you want your friend to become a black hole, so you must have to compress your frame up to a Schwarzschild radius. That is the minimum requirement. And that's all what I have wanted to share with you. And thank you.
Thank you, Arijit. It was also a really, really informative and interesting speech, I must say. Now, is there any questions from the audience? Sir, students?
Orichit, I have just one information I just want to get from you. So have you ever heard the name or the phenomena of bending of light on a massive board? Have you ever heard this? Bending of light.
So is it bending of light? Yes, sir, yes. I have heard it.
Yeah. And the experiment that was carried out to confirm Einstein's general theory of relativity, the predictions of general theory of relativity in creating them. Have you heard this experiment? The name of this experiment?
Yes,
okay. Victor, just
what is it? Thank you, sir. Orijit, I have a little query. Can you explain?
Yes, sir.
You said now that the energy of the photon is h nu minus gm by r squared, that gravitational potential energy from gm by r squared. So from where this potential energy of photon came? Can you explain?
Sir, you all know that the photon do not have any kind of rest mass, but from the Einstein mass principle, we know that E equals mc squared. So if something has energy of E, so we can conclude that it must have some kind of mass associated with that of that energy. That is
right.
So that if I consider that a particle is actually at the surface of, let's say, Earth, so in that case, the potential energy of that particle is actually minus G capital M, which is the mass of the Earth, and small m, which is the mass of the particle, let's say, and by R. So in the photon, as I have actually considered that the effective mass of the photon, so I'm actually replacing the m dash with that of replacing the particle's mass with that of photon's mass. Photon's effective mass.
I see. Thank you.
That is called the moving mass of the photon.
No? Exactly.
Moving.
Thank you, sir.
Actually, the light.
Yes.
Please,
what
are you doing? Hello, sir. Sir, are you saying something?
No. I'm calling that sort of mass is called as the moving mass of the photon.
Moving mass.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Orijit. Now I will ask Rupesh Adhikari to enlighten us with his speech regarding photoelectric effect. We are in search of light. Rupesh, please.
Is my screen visible to you, sir?
Yeah.
Visible.
Good morning, everyone. I am Rupesh Adhikari. Today I am going to discuss about photoelectric effect. In 1865, James Clerk Maxwell introduced wave theory of light. According to this, light is an electromagnetic wave whose energy depends on the intensity of that wave. The more waves incident on a surface per second, the higher the intensity and the energy of the light. A few years later, Philip Lenard discovered the ionization of gas from ultraviolet light and observed that gas absorbs the incident light and emits electrons, whose energy depends on the frequency of light, not on intensity. Lenard's observation was the exact opposite of Maxwell's wave theory of light, which made it a puzzle that the energy of light depends on intensity or frequency. Albert Einstein explained this puzzle through a phenomenon of light called photoelectric effect. The phenomena of emission of electron from a metal surface when radiation of suitable frequency is incident on it is called photoelectric effect. Einstein took the help of Max Planck's radiation law to explain the photoelectric effect. To explain black body radiation, Max Planck suggested that light is not a continuous wave. As Maxwell had said, rather, light consists of particles. Einstein named this quantum of light photon. Each photon is a packet of fixed energy which depends on the frequency of light. The energy of a radiation is equal to the multiple of the frequency of radiation and a very small tiny number, which is called quantum of light, and this small tiny number is called Planck constant. To get it to, he incident light on a metal surface. In metal, electrons were free to move, but they do not have enough energy to eject from metal surface themselves. Because the height of the potential well on the surface is more than the electron's energy, so a fixed amount of energy is required to bring the electron to the metal surface, which is called the electron's work function. When light incident on the metal surface, photons interact with these electrons. During this electron follows all or nothing movement. If energy of the photon is equal or greater than the work function of electron, then the electron absorbs that energy. But if energy of the photon is less than the work function of electron, then it does not absorb that energy at all. If the energy of the photon is exact equal to the work function, then the electron absorbs that energy and only come out to the metal surface. But if the energy of the photon is more than the work function, then the electron spends some part of the entire energy reaching to the surface, and the rest of the remaining energy is converted into kinetic energy. With this kinetic energy, electrons move freely. This is called the photoelectric effect. The photoelectric effect requires that the photon have a minimum required amount of energy. Low energy photons are not able to eject electrons from metal surface. The corresponding frequency of this minimum energy is called threshold frequency. If the frequency of the photon is less than this threshold value, then electrons will not be able to eject from the surface. If the frequency is equal to the threshold value, then they will eject from the surface, but they will not have enough energy left to move further. But if the frequency of photon is more than threshold value, then electrons will not only eject from the surface, but also move with the kinetic energy. This kinetic energy of electron depends on the frequency of photon. The higher the frequency of the photon than threshold value, with more energy electron will eject. So is Maxwell's wave theory about light wrong? Well, it is not so. There are some phenomena of light in nature that can be explained only by Maxwell's wave theory. While other phenomena from Max Planck and Einstein's quantum of light. In this way, light is wave as well as particle. This is called wave-particle duality. De Broglie extended this concept saying that not only light but every quantity of the universe has both particle and wave nature. This dual nature of any quantity is the base of quantum physics. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Rupesh. It was an excellent presentation, Rupesh, I must say. Brilliant presentation, brilliant. Arijit was also brilliant in his presentation. His vocabulary was much more nice. Presentation was also good, and your presentation is superb. At least I enjoyed thoroughly. Thank you very much. Now, is there any questions? Sir, ma'am, or any students, you want to ask anything?
Rupesh?
Yes, sir.
I just want to point out one thing. You have told that the light quanta was named as proton by Einstein. But yes, this is wrong. Actually, this naming of light quanta as proton was done by some chemist, G.N. Lewis. He actually named these things as protons. One thing, that is the misconception or misinformation that we have gathered so far. Second one is that, do you think that photoelectric effect is possible with a free electron?
So please repeat the question, sir.
Do you think that photoelectric effect is at all possible with a free electron?
Sir, as I said, it is possible, sir.
Is it possible? Because you have explained all these things with electrons which are bound in the matter, right? That's why you need a minimum threshold frequency.
Yes,
and
sir.
After getting that frequency or with eliminating with that sort of frequency, photoelectrons can come out of this minimum frequency or greater than that of electrons can come out of the matter. Why this is necessary, this minimum amount of potential or minimum amount of threshold frequency or energy is required to force the electron to come out of this thing? Why this thing is at all?
Because as I said, sir, the height of the potential wave on the surface is more than the electron's energy.
How this potential wave is developed?
Sir, we all know that potential wave is a region, sir, within a place field surrounding a local minimum of potential energy. That's why the particle requires energy.
You need the name of this potential. This is actually called the surface barrier potential. This electron has to come out, has to work on this
barrier, potential barrier.
Surface barrier potential. Okay. And this, so you said that the electron, that photoelectric effect will be possible with a free electron. But actually, this is not true. This is forbidden actually. Into conservation of momentum, linear momentum, and energy simultaneously. We can discuss when we get a chance to meet. Okay.
Thank you, sir. Expressing our heartfelt thanks to Rupesh and MM sir. Now we will proceed to our next participant. I want to say one little sentence in between these two presentations. We all, Sob earlier and Arijit, Rupesh, they said also that light is made up of photon from the corpuscular theory of light, and from wave theory of light we know that light also have a wave nature. Now, there is a duality, wave-particle duality of electron, de Broglie hypothesis. This will be the topic of the presentation of Oshmita. Oshmita, screen is all yours. Please start.
Sir, am I?
Yeah, you are audible. Sometimes the sound is getting off.
So now is it okay?
Okay.
It's okay. It's okay now.
I think the author of Matter and Light, Sir Louis de Broglie, that science itself, no matter whether it is the search or truth or merely the need to gain control over the external world to alleviate suffering, or to prolong life is ultimately a matter of feeling, or rather of desire, the desire to know or the desire to realize. Good afternoon, one and all present here. My name is Oshmita from 6th BSc Physics Honors. Today the topic that I will be discussing about is the wave-particle duality of electrons. Let's begin with the wave-particle duality of light. Initially, light was considered to have wave nature only, and the phenomenon like interference, diffraction, polarization proved that light is a wave. And I too have this misconception that Sir Albert Einstein first proposed the quantum theory of light. I didn't know that, but it's okay. Later in 1905, Sir Albert Einstein proposed the quantum theory of light, that is, light consists of a discrete packet of energies known as a photon. This was later confirmed by the photoelectric effect experiment as well as by the Crompton effect experiment. So this idea that light can act as a particle or it can act as a wave came to be known as the wave-particle duality of light, which is already explained by my friend. Now, in the year 1920, a young French physicist, Sir Louis de Broglie, extended the wave-particle duality to electrons. He said that if light, which we initially thought was a wave, can act a particle, maybe electrons, which we thought were particles, can act like a wave, and the waves are called matter waves. He simply stated that every moving particle has wave associated with it. In fact, he said that the wavelength of electron given by lambda, which is now known as the de Broglie's wavelength, is equal to the ratio of Planck's constant to the momentum of that particular electron. Basically, he was trying to synthesize these ideas into one overarching framework. So maybe he was saying that everything in the universe can behave like a particle or wave, but he actually postulated this. He didn't really prove it, he just motivated the idea. Later in the year 1927, an experiment was conducted that basically confirmed de Broglie's hypothesis. And the experiment came to be known as the Davison-Gamow experiment. In that experiment, electrons were accelerated at a metal surface and they scattered, producing a diffraction pattern. I will discuss this elaborated sections, but for now, so basically, not only light has the wave-particle duality, but also does electron. In fact, it was later confirmed that all subatomic particles like proton, neutron, also have the wave-particle duality. In fact, any macroscopic object can also act as a wave. However, if we apply de Broglie's equation, then we will see that wavelength of macroscopic object is very, very small. Now, getting back to the Davison-Gamow experiment, the experimental setup is as shown in the screen. Basically, it consists of a nickel chloride crystal, which we call the target, an electron gun, and a detector. An electron gun produces a beam of electron. Now, electron gun used by Davison and Gamow consists of a tungsten filament, a high tension and a low tension batteries. Now, what is the function of those two batteries? The low tension battery is used to heat the filament, and this red hot filament produced an electron beam, and the high tension battery was provided to accelerate those electron beams. And the detector electron collector moved on a graduated circular scale. There is also a sensitive galvanometer connected to the detector. Now, how did they actually perform the experiment? That is the working of Davison and Gamow experiment. The electron beam was made to pass through a pinhole, as shown in the screen, the left side picture, and made to strike the crystal normally. The electron gets scattered in all directions, acting like waves. They observed that at certain angle, the detector indicated a peak in the intensity of the scattered electron beam. This maximum intensity was due to the constructive interference, a phenomenon confined only to wave. Thus, they experimentally proved the wave nature of electron. Now, the wavelength of moving electron can be calculated by considering the crystal structure of nickel. Using Bragg's law and using the appropriate values, the wavelength was found to be 1.65 angstrom, which is near about equal to the de Broglie's wavelength of electron, that is 1.67 angstrom, proving the de Broglie's hypothesis once again. Davison and Garmer also plotted a graph taking the angle between the incident and the scattered direction of beam theta along y-axis and intensity of the scattered beam at different values of accelerated potential along x-axis. The nature of the graph is as shown here. From the experimental curves as obtained in the experiment, the following conclusions were drawn. Firstly, the intensity of the scattering depends upon the angle of scattering. A bump or kink always occurs in the curve when theta is equal to 50 degrees. This bump or kink increases as mechanics has not profoundly shocked you, you have not understood it yet. Anyway, I would really like to thank all my teachers, my lovely juniors and my fellow batchmates for their constant help and support. And last but not the least, I would like to thank me for collecting all my confidence and presenting this in front of you. Anyway, thank you and stay safe.
Thank you, Ashmita. Thanks a lot. We in fact just revisited our concept regarding wave particle duality. Now it's time for a very brief or short question answer session. Anybody have any question? Anyone want to ask or discuss anything in brief with Ushmita regarding his topic? Our topic. Okay, you also can write your questions in the chat when anyone is giving his or her presentation. You can already write your question in the chat. Then after his or her presentation, we can go through those questions also. Okay, I think there is no question. Thank you, Ushmita. Actually, what is missing a bit this seminar is a cup of tea. Any seminar goes well with a cup of tea, but what to do? All of you can arrange for a cup of tea at your own. We are really sorry. Anyway, in our world now, there is uncertainty over our illness. There is uncertainty when we will be cured. There is uncertainty when we get vaccinated. There is uncertainty that when we get out of this, for sure. Uncertainty principle will be enlightened by Ishita Dash, our same 6 honor students. Ishita.
Good afternoon, everyone. I am Ishita Dash from Semester 6. My topic is Heisenberg uncertainty principle. The Heisenberg uncertainty principle is one of a handful of ideas of quantum physics that says we can never simultaneously know the exact position and exact speed of an object. The question is, what is uncertainty? Uncertainty is often explained as a result of measurement that the act of measuring an object's position changes its speed or vice versa. The real origin is much deeper and more amazing. The uncertainty principle exists because everything in this universe behaves like both a particle and unit at the same time. In quantum mechanics, the exact position and exact speed of an object have no meaning. To understand this, we need to know what is the dual nature of particle in physics. As previously shown by Osmita, we have a clear view on what is the dual nature of particle. So, based on the view Heisenberg uncertainty principle first stated by German physicist Werner Heisenberg back in 1927. As shown in the picture, we can clearly see that the product of uncertainty in position or delta x and uncertainty in momentum or delta p is greater than equal to h by 4 pi or h cut by 2. From this we can tell the more accurately you know the position, that is the smaller the delta x gets, the less accurately you know the momentum, that is the larger the delta p becomes, or vice versa. So Heisenberg realized that in this world of very small particles, one cannot measure any property of a particle without interacting with it in some way. This introduced an unavoidable uncertainty into the result. One can never measure all the properties exactly. Now, let's talk about experimental verification of this principle, or the gamma ray microscope experiment. Heisenberg's gamma ray microscope experiment is one of the thought experiments which is used to experimentally verify uncertainty principle. As shown in the picture, this is the gamma ray microscope what can be used to find the position and momentum of the electron. From the picture 1, electron is present on point O, and in order to see it, we will incident a gamma ray on it. If the gamma ray enters the objective lens after colliding with the electron, then we can see it. Here lambda is the wavelength and alpha is the semi-vertical angle. And also microscope is characterized by a resolving power, that is, its ability to separate two closely spaced objects, and the resolving power is given by delta x equal to lambda by 2 sine alpha, which is equal to uncertainty of the position. Now let us calculate the uncertainty of momentum. As we can see, initial momentum of gamma ray is p dash. At picture 2, after colliding with the electron, the photon will enter between any direction, OA or OB. If the gamma ray photon enters along OB, then its x component of momentum would be p sine alpha. Hence, the momentum imparted to the electron would be p dash minus p sine alpha. Also, if it enters along OA, then its x component would be minus p sine alpha, and the momentum would be p dash minus minus p sine alpha equal to p dash plus p sine alpha. Thus, the uncertainty is momentum of the electron delta px is p dash plus p sine alpha minus p dash minus p sine alpha equal to 2 p sine alpha. Now, we have both the values of delta x and delta px at equation 1 and equation 2. Using both equations, we can see delta x into delta px equal to h, which is greater than h by 4 pi, and this is the uncertainty relation. Thus, we can experimentally verify the uncertainty principle. Now, I am going to talk about some applications of this principle. As we can see from point 1, non-existence of electron in nuclear. We have the radius of an atom which is 5×10⁻¹⁵ meter. If electron exists in the nucleus, then the delta x max would be 5×10⁻¹⁵ meter. From the calculation, we can see that the energy E is 20 mega electron volt, but the rest energy of the electron is 0.5 mega electron volt, very low as compared to 20 mega electron volt. Thus, it proves the non-existence of electron in nuclear. We can also find from point 2.8 and the energy of the hydrogen atom, which is minus 13.6 electron volt, and from 2b the size of the hydrogen atom using uncertainty relation, which is the radius r equal to 0.5. Now I am going to talk about a very interesting topic of uncertainty, which is called Schrodinger's cat. You already know Erwin Schrodinger, and famous Austrian physicist, is one of the founder of quantum mechanics. But he is most famous for something that he never actually did in a practical lab, which is a thought experiment involving a cat. So he imagined taking a cat and placing it in a sealed box with a device that has a 50% chance of killing the cat in the next hour. At the end of the hour, he asks, what is the state of the cat? Common sense suggests that the cat is either alive or dead. But Schrodinger pointed out that according to quantum physics, at the instant before the box is opened, the cat is equal part alive and dead at the same time. It's only when the box is opened that we can see a single definite state. Until then, the cat is a blur of probability, half one and half another. This seems absurd, which is also Schrodinger's point. He found quantum physics so philosophically disturbing that he rejected his own theory and turned to writing about biology. As absurd as may seem, Schrodinger's cat is very real. In fact, it's essential. If it was not possible for quantum objects to be in two states at once, then the computer or mobile phone you are using to watch this seminar would not even exist. This experiment helps us to understand how electrons are shared among atoms and allows us to make transistor on a tiny scale and millions on a single computer chip. And those chips generate the electronic device you are using right now. With this, I come to the end of my topic. So I want to thank all my professors, my beloved juniors, and also my supporting classmates. Lastly, I am ending my topic with a famous quote from Sir Albert Einstein. As far as the law of mathematics refer to reality, they are not certain. And as far as they are certain, they do not refer to reality. Thank you. Stay home. Stay safe.
Thank you, Ishita. It was also a very nice presentation from Ishita Dash. Now I will ask anyone of the audience, from the audience, that do you have any queries, any questions regarding this topic of Ishita?
I just want to point out one thing about Ishita's
yes, lecture.
In the primary stages of this slide, first two slides for us, Ishita wrote one thing, that delta x into delta p is equal to h by 2, h cut by 2. Actually, delta x into delta p x, the x component of position of the particle and the x component, corresponding x component of momentum. If delta x into delta p y, that should be equal. So there should be a minor correction in this slide.
Yes, sir. Yeah.
And
in my photo, there is the delta p is delta p x. This is my bad.
Okay. And the other thing is that once again, I just want to clarify one thing, that the naming of photon, the light quanta as photon, was done by G. N. Lewis, a chemist, not the quantum theory. But I just want to clarify this.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay. Sir, who was the first one to propose light as photon?
That is the G.N. Lewis, a chemist. The naming of quanta as photon was done by G.N. Lewis, a LWIS, a chemist.
Okay. Thank you, Ishita. Thank you, sir. That is, in fact, also a very new information to me, too. That it was named by J. Lewis.
Actually, I have collected this information from this resonance, this article, this published by the Indian Institute of Science, and this was first published in the year of the 100 years of Einstein's paper. Then there are some collected papers of the resonance has published some collected papers of Einstein. There it was referred. I can show you this.
Okay. Okay, thank you, sir. Thanks a lot. Everything regarding photon, I think, is crystal clear. But not the crystal structure. Now, actually, I want to say that crystal structure is a new topic of presentation now, and it will be presented by our 6th student, Poulomi Dash. Poulomi, crystal structure.
Can I order, sir?
Okay. Good afternoon, everyone. I am Poulomi Dash, student of Semester 6, BSc Physics Honours. Today, I am going to discuss about crystal structure. So, what is crystallography? Put simply, it is the study of crystals. It has a long history going back to the 17th century. Property of the symmetry of the crystals suggested an underlying order of some kind. For the next 3 centuries, our knowledge of what crystals actually were was based on conjecture and argument with a few experiments thrown in. From their symmetry and shapes, it was argued that crystals must consist of ordered arrangements of small particles, today known as atoms and molecules. But it was the discovery of X-rays in 1895 that changed all that. For a few years later, in 1912 in Germany, Max von Laue, Walter Frederick and Paul Knipping showed that an X-ray beam incident on a crystal was scattered to form a regular pattern of spots on a film. Thus, it was proved that X-ray consists of waves, and this gave direct evidence of the underlying order of atoms in the crystal. Hence, Nobel Prize number 1 went to Max von Laue in 1914. However, it was William Lawrence Bragg who in 1912 showed how the observed diffraction pattern could be used to determine the positions of atoms in the crystal, thus launching a completely new scientific discipline, X-ray crystallography. Working with his father, William Henry Bragg, they quickly determined the crystal structure of several materials, starting with that of common salt and diamond. Both shared Nobel Prize in 1915. Since then, X-ray crystallography, which today is used throughout the world, has been the method of choice for determining crystal structures of organic and inorganic solids, pharmaceuticals, and all kinds of solids. So, there are 3 types of materials exist in nature: solids, liquids, and gases. For solids, atoms are arranged in a fixed manner and have definite shape and size. But for liquids and gases, atoms or molecules are not arranged in a fixed manner and cannot form any shape or size. They gain the shape and size of the container. Now let's talk about solids. So, basing on the arrangements of the atoms, solid materials are classified into 2 groups. Crystalline solids and non-crystalline solids. The solids in which atoms or molecules are arranged in a regular and orderly manner in 3D pattern are called crystalline solids. Examples are gold, silver, aluminium, diamond, NaCl, etc. And in non-crystalline solids, the atoms or molecules are arranged in an irregular manner and they have no lattice structure. Examples are glass, plastic, rubber, etc. Crystalline solids are classified into single crystal and polycrystal based on their grains. Crystalline solids are also classified based on bonding as covalent, metallic, ionic and molecular solids. Again, based on dimension, covalent solids are classified into 2-dimensional and 3-dimensional solids. Molecular solids are also classified into polar, non-polar and hydrogen bonded solids.
Let's move on to what is crystal. A crystal or crystalline solid is a solid material whose constituents such as atoms, molecules or ions are arranged in a highly ordered microscopic structure forming a crystal lattice that extend in all directions. So, an arrangement of infinite number of imaginary points in 3D space with each point having identical surroundings is known as point lattice or space lattice, as we can see in the picture. In order to make crystal structure, atom or group of atoms is to be placed at lattice points. These atoms or group of atoms are called bases. So we can see in the screen that crystal structure is equal to lattice plus bases. Now, the smallest structure by which total crystal structure can be formed is called unit cell. In 2D lattice, parallelogram, square or rectangle is unit cell of the crystal, and in 3D lattice, parallelepiped is the unit cell of the crystal. Now, there are various types of lattices. In 2 dimensions, there are 5 types of crystal structures, that is square lattice, rectangular lattice, parallelogram lattice, hexagonal lattice and rhombic lattice, as shown in the screen. In 3 dimensions, there are 7 types of Gravis lattices: triclinic, monoclinic, orthorhombic, tetragonal, trigonal, cubic and hexagonal lattice. As you can see in this chart, orthorhombic lattice has 4 types of crystal structure: simple, volume centered, base centered and face centered. For monoclinic and tetragonal, they are simple and volume centered structure. For triclinic, hexagonal and trigonal, only simple crystal structure exists. And for cubic, simple, volume centered and face centered crystal structure exists. Let's discuss about simple crystal structures. There are 2 types, closely packed and loose packed structure. In close packed structure, the atoms in a unit cell are oriented in such manner so that minimum amount of volume will remain vacant. Examples of close packed structures are hexagonal close packed structure, that is HCP, and face centered cubic structure, that is FCC. In hexagonal close-packed structure, the unit cell is a hexagon. There are 12 atoms on the corners with 1 by 6 of their volume inside the unit cell and 3 atoms inside the cell with 100% of their volume inside the unit cell and 2 atoms on the faces with half of their volume inside the unit cell. So, effective number of atoms in the unit cell is 6. Here volume of the atom is 6 into 4 by 3 pi r cube, and volume of the unit cell is 24 root 2 r cube. So packing fraction of HCP is 0.74, that is 74% volume of unit cell is filled up by atom in HCP. And for face centered cubic structure, we consider A is the length of the sides of the cube and R is the radius of each atom. So there are 8 atoms on each corner with 1 by 8 of its volume inside the unit cell and 6 atoms on each face with half of its volume inside the unit cell. So effective number of atoms in FCC unit cell is 4. Volume of the atom is 4 into 4 by 3 pi r cube, and volume of unit cell is 2 root 2 r whole cube. So packing fraction of HCC is 0.74, that is 74% of the unit cell is filled up by atoms. Now, for loose packed structure, most of the volume of the unit cell remains vacant. The example of 2 loose packed structure are body centered cubic structure, that is BCC, and simple cubic structure is SC. For BCC lattice, 8 atoms on each corner with 1/8 of its volume inside the unit cell and one full atom is inside. So effective number of atoms is 2. Volume of the atoms is 2 × 4/3πr³ and volume of the unit cell is 4√3r³. So packing fraction is 0.68, that is 68% volume of cell is filled up by atom. And for ST lattice, the effective number of atoms is 1. Volume of the atom is 4√3πr³ and volume of the cube is 8r³. So packing fraction is 0.52, that is 52% volume of unit cell will be occupied by the atoms. With this, I come to an end of this topic. I would like to thank my professors to give me this opportunity to be a part of this seminar and my fellow classmates and beloved juniors for making this seminar a success. Thank you. Stay home and stay safe.
Thank you, Poulomi. The angles of the unit cells of cubic lattice and others are crystal clear. Any questions from the audience?
Okay, move on. Victor.
Okay. So, thank you, sir. Thank you, Poulomi, once more. Actually, in offline mode of any seminar, this is the ideal time for a seminar lunch break with a mouth-watering lunch pack. But unfortunately, for today, we have to consider our home lunch as the seminar lunch. Anyway, we are almost at the end part of our today's seminar. Swaraj Mukherjee will be our next speaker and he will be speaking regarding holography. Swaraj, please proceed.
Good afternoon to all of you. Am I audible to you?
Yeah, you are audible.
Okay, now I'm going to share my screen through this online platform. I am Swaraj Mukherjee from BSc Physics Honors 6th semester, Hubli Mohsin College. Today's topic of my presentation is based on holography and its application. Okay, now let me discuss about the contents of my topic. Introduction of holography, hologram, hologram properties, working of holography, recording a hologram, applications of holography, photography versus holography, advantages and disadvantages, and at the last conclusion. So now, in our modern world, there are a lot of application and uses of holography, from our human body surgery and other medical purpose to making a film. Everywhere we can see the use of holograms. Mainly in modern teaching and education, holography takes plays an important role. In most of the horror movies and other Hollywood and Bollywood movies like Iron Man, Krish, Dhoom 2, we are able to see many types of 3D holograms. Okay, now I'm going to discuss about the history of holography. It was first suggested by Denis Gabor in 1947, who was a Hungarian British engineer. But he published his whole thesis in 1948. So we can also write 1948 as the invention year. You can see his picture on the screen. Later, he was well known as the father of holography. Then he got the Nobel Prize in Physics in 1971. Okay, now I am going to enter in our main topic. Basically, it's a seminar which is not only about our physics department. That's why I'm trying to neglect the numericals regarding this topic and focusing on the theory part only. So, with that said, let's roll the intro. D. Gabor coined the term hologram from the Greek word holos, H-O-L-O-S, holos, meaning whole, and gramma, G-R-A-M-M-A, gramma, meaning message, which means that the whole of informations. Basically, the science of producing holograms. From the definition, holography is a method of producing a visual three-dimensional image of an object by means of light wave patterns recorded on a photographic plate. It is also known as lensless photography, which can create lifelike images. Our next topic is hologram, a photography of an interference pattern which, when suitably illuminated by laser light, produces a three-dimensional image. Okay, we talked before that holography produces three-dimensional images. That means you can see the image moving or existing in front of you. You can feel it in your own vision, but you can't touch it. All I am trying to say that we can create alter character that can be living or non-living of any object existing in our world. But remember one thing, holograms are only created by laser lights. Okay. Now, hologram properties. If you look at the hologram from different angles, you see objects from different perspectives, just like you would if you were looking at a real object. It shows divisible property, that is, if you cut one in half, each half contains whole views of the entire holographic image. This divisible property is the main feature of this hologram. Okay, so what is this divisible property? In normal 2D pictures, which are clicked by our own cameras, if we turn that one picture into small pieces and take one small piece, then we can't detect the original picture, or we can't get any idea of the original picture from that one small piece of torn picture. But in holograms, we can do so. We can get the full idea of the original hologram, or we can detect the original hologram from that one small torn piece. Next, working of holography. In this topic, working of holography, we need a laser light, usually helium neon laser light, beam splitter. Beam splitter is a device that uses mirrors and prism to split laser beams into two beams. These are object beams, and second is reference beam. We will discuss about object beam and reference beam later. The third one is mirror, direct the beam of light to correct locations. And the fourth one is holographic film, to record image very high resolution. These holograms can be seen through naked eyes, and also images float on free space, as I told before. So next, our main topic, how to create a hologram. Okay, to create a hologram, a laser beam, coherent light, is splitted into two beams. So here is the word coherent source, light or coherent source. So what is that coherent source? These are both sources which emits a light wave having the same frequency wavelength in the same phase, or they have a constant phase difference. This coherence is divided into two parts, temporal coherence and spatial coherence. So leave it because it's out of our topic. Now, the working of holography is divided into two phases. One is recording and the second one is reconstruction. So our first part is recording. So now let me talk about the first process named recording. A beam of a coherent light from a laser source is split into two parts by a semi-transparent mirror, such that one beam called object beam is scattered by the object and the other beam, phase-related reference beam, falls directly on the film. Due to path difference, these two beams form interference pattern on the film and the fine speckled pattern on the film, which contains information regarding both amplitude and phase. Okay, here you can see from the picture that the light coming from the laser source is reflected by a semi-transparent mirror. The semi-transparent means this mirror can't reflect the whole amount of light. That's why the light is divided into two parts. First one is going through the object. This is called the object beam, and the second one is the reference beam. These two beams superimpose each other and create an interference pattern on the screen and produce a hologram. Okay, now the next one is reconstruction. When a hologram is later illuminated with coherent light of the same frequency that created it, a three-dimensional image of the subject appears. Reconstruction is a huge and more complicated process than recording. In this process, we can create 3D holograms, as I told you earlier. I am neglecting briefly discussions, so here you can see from the picture that the hologram acts as a diffraction grating, producing two sets of diffracted beams. One set forms a real image while the other forms a three-dimensional virtual image. As we know that in our perspective world, light always travels through straight lines. That's why we can directly see the 3D virtual image from our own naked eyes. That you can see from the picture. Okay. So now our next topic is the applications of holography. There is a lot of applications regarding this topic, holography. And I hope in upcoming generation, the uses of holography will be at a high rate. Some of its applications are optical computers, biomedical applications, compact discs, laser, holographic scanners, and the last one is holostores. Okay. Our first application is optical computers. Optical computers will use holograms as circuit elements. Parallel processing is made possible because when a hologram is addressed, all the information comes out simultaneously. So, in the first line, optical computers will use holograms as circuit elements. So, what is the circuit elements? Circuit elements are nothing but the part of an electronic circuit or networks, as a generator, switch, lamp, vacuum tube, etc. And the other, our three quantitative attributes like resistance, inductance, and capacitance, which characterize the circuit. Okay. Our next application is biomedical application. Biomedical applications of holography is actively pursued in the US and Europe. Holograms are made inside live organs through optical fibers, providing more details than any previous alternate techniques. Next one, compact disc. Compact disc players use holograms to handle light. Here you can see from the picture. And the other one is grocery stores. Grocery store scanners are spinning holograms. So spinning holograms are nothing but a hologram which can rotate, into itself like our Earth. And next one is holographic interferometry. So holographic interferometry. Holographic interferometry is used in numerous laboratories for non-destructive testing. It visually reveals structural faults without damaging the specimen. At first, we need to know what is an interferometry. Basically, it is a measurement method using the phenomenon of interference of waves, usually light, radio, or sound waves. Okay, so holographic interferometry is a technique which enables static and dynamic displacements of objects with optically rough surface to be measured to optical interferometric precision. Next is holographic scanner. In various stores, we can see this holographic scanner. Holographic scanners are used in store checkout counters for reading the barcodes. A rotating computer-generated hologram is responsible for the both scanning and the detecting of the scattered light. These are very useful nowadays. And the last one is holostore. Holostore is a holographic computer memory system being manufactured to replace your disk drive. It will have 1,000 times more memory capacity and no mechanical movements. This memory capacity or holographic data storage is a potential technology in the area of high capacity data storage. That's why the holograms can store a huge amount of data. Video gaming living room and teaching and education. In video gaming living room, here we can see the objects in the game as in 3D shapes. Here you can see in the picture. And in modern teaching and education technique, there are lots of applications and uses of holograms. Okay, now we are in our next topic, photography versus holography. So the basic difference between photography and holography as follows. Photography is a 2D recording process, whereas holography is a 3D recording process. Ordinary light can be used in photography, but in holography, as I told earlier, that only laser light can be used. Photography is a lens system and holography is a lensless system. So in photography, image has poor resolution or poor quality, but in holography, images have a high resolution or high quality. Now, the next topic is advantages and disadvantages of holography. So let me discuss about the advantages of holography. Holograms are cost effective, higher storage capacity. I told before that holograms can store a data, a huge amount of data. Increased feasibility of objects enables the achievements of multiple images on a single plate and give 3D images. Ability to combine with other technologies. And the disadvantages are provide static images. So static images are nothing but still images. The images which can't move. But in modern technology, there is also holograms can also be create dynamic images. Do not produce images of complex movement. Require complicated precise machinery to produce and view an image. Reference illumination becomes our collinear. Now, here we come to the end of my presentation. The last part is conclusion. Holographic technology has endless application as far as the human mind can imagine. Holographic technologies are not just about art or business communication. They are about safety, security, education, planning, and the strength of our civilization here and beyond. Holographic technology will become a very integral part of human societies and civilization in future. So at the end, Dennis Gabor said one sentence that the future cannot be predicted, but the future can be invented. So I hope in modern, in upcoming generations, there will be a lot of application that holography. And with that, that's it. Thank you for listening.
Thank you, Faraj. It was a nice presentation. Now, there is a brief question answer session. Will anybody have any questions? I have got already one question from Sudipto Ghosh. He asked that do all the 3D cameras contain all these? Faraj?
No. These 3D cameras cannot create a hologram.
Anybody else? Sir, ma'am?
Faraj? Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Why laser plays an important necessary role in producing a hologram? What actual property of laser plays this important role?
If you see it through the vision of teaching, then you can see that when the teachers teach us the any topic in by drawing in a blackboard or any showing any picture, then it will not so clear to the students. That's why if they use holograms instead of blackboard or any picture, it can be more easy to understand that through these 3D images, by the 3D images.
So that is the supremacy of the 3D images. But what I want to ask you, that why laser plays so important role in producing holograms? What actual property of laser?
Because laser light produces monochromatic intense view of light, whereas white light does not create an interference pattern. They are just illuminated on the surface. That's why we use laser to create a hologram.
Any other property?
Any other property? That means I can see a question that storage capacity. What does it mean? So holographic data storage is a potential technology. So the potential technology is out of our syllabus hologram, how to store data, a lots of amount of data in it. So it's out of our syllabus. That's why I can't tell briefly description about this potential technology. But through this technology, hologram can store a huge amount of data.
Sharaj, there is one more question from Pritika. Are you seeing it? Divisibility property tati bujhte parini kena.
Okay. Divisibility property is that one. Am I audible to you?
Yeah.
You are audible.
I am repeating the divisible property. if you take a picture by your own camera, it is a 2D picture, okay? And then you turn it, otherwise you cut it into 3 or 4 pieces and take one small piece. Then you can't detect the original picture from that one small picture, that original picture. You can't detect the original picture, or you can't get any full idea of the original picture. But in holograms, if you cut any holograms or any holographic any data into 3 or 2 pieces, then and take one piece, turn hologram, and you can get the full idea, or you can get the original, the full idea of the original hologram, or detect the original hologram from that one small piece. This property is known as divisible property of a hologram.
Okay, Kritika, I have one more questions. I think
It all happened because of interference pattern.
Okay. Okay. With that, here is the end of Shorad's speech, and we will quickly move to our penultimate speech of today's seminar. From this material world, Sudeep Malik will take us to the interstellar medium. Interstellar medium by Sudeep Malik. Sudeep, carry on, please.
Sir, am I audible?
Yeah, you are audible. You're absolutely.
So today I will discuss about a important field of the study in astronomy and astrophysics. Interstellar means that the space in interstellar is the matter and the radiation that is the space, the star system in a galaxy.
Hello. Sudhi, 1 minute. Sorry for interruption. But to me, the sound is interrupting. I don't know to all others, is it doing or the sound is interrupting? To me, it is sometimes it's coming, sometimes not coming.
Sound is interrupting. So now, sir, is it okay?
It's better now.
So today I will discuss about the interstellar medium. Now the interstellar space means that the space in between the star system. So the interstellar medium, or ISM, is the matter and the radiation that exist in the space between the star system in a galaxy. This matter include gas in ionic, atomic and molecular form, as well as dust and cosmic rays. If we look at our solar system, we can see a bubble like region in the space that surrounds and created by the sun. It is the cavity from the sun in the surrounding interstellar medium. It is known as a heliosphere. The bubble of the heliosphere is continuously inflated by the plasma originating from the sun, known as solar wind. Outside the heliosphere, the solar plasma gives the way to the interstellar plasma, permitting the Milky Way galaxy. There is a interstellar medium and it is heliosphere. Now, the interstellar medium is filled primarily with hydrogen gas, and relatively significant amount of helium has also been detected. along with smaller percentages of such substances like calcium, sodium, water, ammonia, formaldehyde, silicates, etc. Sizable quantities of dust particles of uncertain composition are present as well. In addition, primary cosmic rays travel through the interstellar space and magnetic field threads their way across the much of the region. Let's discuss about the three phases of the interstellar medium. First one is cold neutral media. This media contains neutral atomic hydrogen and ionized or charged hydrogen molecules. Neutral media only contains neutral hydrogens, which are atomic, and some are molecular hydrogen clouds. Temperature is very low in this region, which lies in between 15 Kelvin to 100 Kelvin. They are also the densest spots in the interstellar media, with density ranges from 100 to 10 to the power 6 particles per cubic centimeter. These are the regions are very compact, and if we look our own galaxy, it take up only 1% of the volume of the Milky Way. Now, second is warm, neutral and ionized media. So this area contains H1 and H2 regions. Now H1 regions contains atomic neutral hydrogens, and H2 region contains ionized hydrogen that resides near the star formation location. They are warm and thin. Their temperatures ranges between 6000 Kelvin and 12000 Kelvin, with densities lies around one particle for every 100 cubic centimeters, like one particle in a volume taken by 100 sugar cubes. And the third is the hot ionized media. These are the hottest zones in the interstellar media, and make up with the bulk of the volume of the interstellar medium. Then the temperature are between 10 to the power 6 and 10 to the power 7 Kelvin, and they are extremely thin gases with densities between 10 to the power 4 to 10 to the power 2 particles per cubic centimeter. These regions are shock heated by supernova and make up what's called galactic corona. Compare this with the number of densities of roughly 10 to the power 19 molecules per centimeter for air at sea level, and 10 to the power 10 molecules per centimeter for a laboratory high vacuum chamber. So the densities of these three regions are very low. If we look here in say hydrogen emission, now this is the components of interstellar media, the fractional volume and how we observe them.
Sudeep, again the sound is not coming. I think it's coming. We can see the we can see your presentation, but can't hear you.
Wavelength of 21 centimeter.
Yeah, now it's okay.
So the cold dense media confined in the plane of the Milky Way. And this is the cloud of the carbon monoxide, which radiate energy in microwave wavelength, and this map of that the those gases are taken by European Space Agency's Planck Observatory. This is the Milky Way in H alpha, which is due to the ionized gases. These are the places where we call the star formation area. So this is the hot interstellar media, and this is the this is Milky Way galaxy in X-ray, which demonstrates the galactic corona. Now, if we look at our dust particles of the interstellar media, the contribution of dust particle is only 1% in the media. The tiny interstellar dust grains absorb some star lights, they interact, but at least half of the star lights that interacts with a grain is merely scattered. That is the redirected rather than the absorbed. Since neither absorbed nor the scattered starlight reaches us directly, both of the absorption and scattering make the stars look dimmer. This effect of both processes are called interstellar extinction. The astronomer first come to understand the interstellar extinction around early 1930 as the explanation of puzzling observation. In the early part of 20th century, astronomers discovered that some stars look red even though their spectral lines indicates that they must be extremely hot. The solution to this seeming contradiction turned out to be that the light coming from those hot stars is not only dimmed but also reddened by interstellar dust. This phenomenon is known as interstellar reddening. As the dust grains can absorb or scatter most of the visible wavelength in this area or region look like a dark cloud, and the reason why the stars look like red because the dust cloud preferentially absorb and scatter the blue light of the spectrum. So we are the left with the red light, so it look like it's making the all stars red, but it's not actually red, it's actually the just simply removing the blue light, so we see the only red light. Now if we take the infrared imaging of this for longer wavelength, we can see more through it because the infrared light will pass through the dust. In most cases, the interstellar matter occurs in cloud-like concentration, which sometimes condense enough to form a star. These are the picture of nebula. It is a concentration of interstellar cloud and made of interstellar medium like hot, ionized gases, dust, etc. There are many highly dense and hot, bright regions that exist in nebula from where new stars are born. During their leaves and death, the star interacts physically with the interstellar medium. This is our Orion Nebula, and you can see the bright and condensed regions, and from here the new baby stars are born. Now the interstellar medium is studied by several methods. Until mid-20th century, virtually all information was obtained by analyzing the effect of interstellar matter on the light coming from the distant star with the help of optical telescopes. Since early 1950s, much of the research has been conducted by radio telescopes, which enable astronomers to study and emit radio waves from the tune of the interstellar medium. For example, as I told, the neutral hydrogen atom absorb or emit all the energy particular with only 21 centimeters in laser point, and compare with nearby wavelength absorbing and radiating hydrogen clouds can be detected. Optical and radio emission have provided much of the information on the interstellar medium. In recent years, the use of infrared telescope orbit light observers that has also contributed to quite. This is Voyager 1 and Voyager 2. Voyager 1 and Voyager 2, two space probes launched by NASA, which is successfully crossed our solar system and heliopause and entered finally the interstellar medium on 25 August 2012 and 8 November 2018 respectively. They are currently situated in interstellar medium. In spite of being old, they send us many information of interstellar medium, like magnetic nature, radiation, temperature of the interstellar. So that's all. Thank you very much. Stay home, stay safe.
Thank you, Sudip. Although the sound was disturbing a bit sometimes.
Sir, here is network issue.
Yeah, but we were actually in the interstellar medium for a while, definitely. Thank you. Any questions? I think we have already one question in the chat box. What is that? Kritika Vishwas written that I understand what's happening, but I don't understand why it is happening. Even if the that was for hologram. Mohit Pramanik asked, what is nebula?
Nebula is a concentrated, dense, and interstellar medium where hydrogen gas and ionized gas are very concentrated, and from this area new stars are born. Some of the area of the nebula, we can see the bright spots in every picture. I can show you. This is our Orion Nebula. We can see the those bright spots, and from here the new baby stars are born. So nebula is the concentration of nothing but the clouds of interstellar medium, like hydrogen gas, dust, helium gas, or heavy metals, etc.
Thank you. Although we had an answer from Devdevipan, that is daughter of Thanos. Nebula. Anyway, any other questions from anyone of the audience? Okay, then we have to move to our last participant, Srijan Banerjee, and he will enlighten us on second law of thermodynamics, entropy, heat death of universe. I think heat death will happen in future, and I think it will be better than this pandemic yet. Srijan, please.
Am I audible?
Yeah, you are audible. Where else? Okay.
I am Srijan Banerjee. It's the birthday of my mother.
Now you are not audible, Srijan. Now you are not audible.
You have to be a bit more loud, Srijan, by any means.
So, sir.
Yeah, it's better.
Okay, now I am going to discuss the second law of thermodynamics, and then followed by the thermal death of universe. As far we have been discussing the properties of matter. As far we have been discussing the properties of matter from the atomic point of view, trying to understand roughly what will happen if we suppose that things are made of atoms obeying certain laws. However, there are a number of relationships among the properties of substances which can be worked out without consideration of the detailed structure of the materials. The determination of the relationships among the various properties of materials without knowing their internal structure is the subject of thermodynamics. Historically, thermodynamics was developed before an understanding of the internal structure of matter was achieved. There is a famous quote given by Albert Einstein about classical thermodynamics. He was very convinced about this. Now, I am going to discuss the second law, which overcomes the limitations given by first law of thermodynamics. Now, we all know that first law of thermodynamics is a statement about conservation of energy for thermodynamic processes. It gives us no information about the way thermodynamic systems evolve as well as about the direction of flow of natural processes. In this way, this places no restriction on the extent of convertibility of heat into work. Can we achieve 100% efficiency? It gives us no answer. But according to the first law of thermodynamics, if this the type of engine which can achieve 100% efficiency is really possible, then the energy crisis would not have been an issue for world economy. We can similarly consider many other natural processes in which energy is conserved, but they never happen. In this scenario, the second law of thermodynamics comes, and this principle, in fact, the second law goes far beyond the efficiency of heat engines. It also serves to define the thermodynamic temperature and resolves the problem of how natural processes proceed or system evolve thermodynamically. Now, I am coming to the statements of second law of thermodynamics. Second law of thermodynamics is based on only two statements. One is Kelvin-Planck statement, and the another is Clausius statement. I am stating the Kelvin-Planck statement as you are. It is visible in screen. It is impossible to construct an 100% efficient engine. This is the summary of this Kelvin-Planck statement. And there is another alternative but logically equivalent statement for the second law by Clausius, who considered the working of a refrigerator that abstracts some heat at a low temperature and rejects a greater amount at a higher temperature. This is Clausius' statement. It is impossible to construct a device which operating in a cycle will produce no other effect than transfer of heat from a colder to a hotter body. Now, it can be easily proved that Kelvin-Planck statement and Clausius statement are equivalent. If anyone is true in any thermodynamical process, then another will definitely will be true. Then I am coming with another interesting subject of thermodynamics, which is known by Carnot's theorem. This theorem states that working between the same two temperature limits, no engine can be more efficient than a reversible one. This is the picture of Carnot. Carnot theorem on the efficiency of heat engine and the second law of thermodynamics are logically equivalent. Then I am coming to the most popular topic, entropy. Entropy is actually here written the price of structure. When the universe begins after Big Bang, there is a deal between universe and every orderness. If I want to construct something which is highly ordered form, then I have to always pay universe something. This is actually entropy. Universe always wants from us entropy, and then it gives us some ordered structure of energy. Now here is the calculation or mathematical expression of entropy. I am showing here a reversible Carnot engine. This is the structure, and then this equation 5, Q1 by Q1 is equal to Q2 by Q2. This comes up with the calculation of the isothermal expansion and adiabatic expansion. This is the equation that if it is written as we see that when we have two engines, one working between T1 and 1 degree and the other working between T2 and 1 degree, delivering the same heat at unit temperature, then the heat absorbed must be related by this equation. Now, in this equation, it is seen that Q1 by T1 is equal to Q2 by T2. If I see this equation in the sense that as one is absorbed and the other is delivered, this suggests that if we call Q by T something, we can say in a reversible process, as much Q by T is absorbed as is liberated, there is no gain or loss of Q by T. This Q by T is called entropy, and we say there is no net change in entropy in a reversible cycle. Now I am coming to the Clausius inequality, which can be proved using the Carnot theorem, and this will be useful to prove the principle of increase of entropy, which is a sole phenomena of our present day universe. The Clausius inequality is a step towards generalization of thermodynamic results for reversible processes. Here it is the complete proof of Clausius inequality, and the ultimate result is this equation cyclic integral over delta Q by T always less equals to 0. Inequality holds only for irreversible process. In reversible process, the equality holds. Now I am coming to entropy change in an irreversible process. Every natural processes are irreversible, so we are more interested in irreversible processes. And here it is, for the calculation, I am seeing that this equation is the result. S2 minus S1, that is entropy change, always greater or equal to this integral value, 1 to 2 del Q by T. Now I am coming to the proof of principle of increase of entropy. Entropy, there is the detailed proof that see this equation delta S system plus delta S surrounding is equal to delta S universe always greater equals to 0. Then I am coming to the entropy form of first law. There is a proof that the first law, first and second can be combined, and coming to this equation number 4. And this result can be used to derive many important thermodynamical results. We will first use it to calculate the entropy change of an ideal gas. Now I am coming a very interesting topic, entropy and unavailable energy. There is a detailed proof that The statement is the energy that becomes unavailable for work during an irreversible process is T0 times the increase in entropy of the universe brought about by the process. That is a detailed proof. This equation E is equal to T0 delta S satisfies that. Now, that energy will become unavailable. I will discuss this later. Now, entropy is related to disorder. That is the, I'm going to discuss the physical significance of entropy. And this picture is highly ordered to entropy increase leads toward more disordered state of matter and energy. And William Gibbs describes entropy as a measure of mixedupness of a system. What he intends to communicate by this illuminating term is the following. Energy is useful for electrical, mechanical or chemical is organized and directed energy, and only such energy can be utilized for the performance of work. Heat, on the other hand, is a form of energy due to random motion of atoms or molecules in a body and is therefore disorderly or chaotic in character. It is possible to regard all natural processes from the point of view of transition from order to disorder. Entropy's physical significance can be briefly described as entropy is thus a measure of disorder of the system, and this is its physical significance. Now a famous equation present, that is known as Boltzmann law, which statistically we can prove that here W is the statistical mechanics proof that the disorder of the system by the theory of probability and expressed by the quantity W. This W is called thermodynamical probability, and it is related with the entropy of the system as S is equal to K ln W. Now I am going to discuss about the entropy and direction of any natural processes. A process will always occur in such a direction that would cause an increase in entropy of the universe. This is the conclusion of second law of thermodynamics, that a natural process will always undergo the increase of entropy. Now I will see, is there any value or significance of absolute entropy? That absolute entropy, so long we discussed only entropy changes of a system in transition from an initial state to a final one. But the question arises, is there any absolute standard state of a system in which the entropy is zero? If it does exist, we can speak of the absolute entropy of a system by calculating its entropy change from the zero state. It was Planck who first suggested that the entropy of a single crystal at absolute zero should be taken as zero. But what in fact is the significance of zero entropy? Zero entropy has the statistical implication that it corresponds to a complete absence of all types of disorder. This can be easily guessed that before Big Bang there may be a zero entropy state of the universe. Then I am coming with the information and entropy. Entropy is related to the information as well. By the equation, the information content, and the additive equation is Q is equal to minus K log P. Now, P is the probability of the statement and K is a constant and it has to be positive. The average information content S is given by S is equal to average Q, which is given by this equation, where S is called Shannon entropy. Here in the words of Bilua, entropy measures the lack of information about the exact state of a system. Information therefore may be considered as negentropy. Now I am going to discuss the entropy and black hole. Black hole is now widely considered as cosmic object in which mass can only enter but not leave. It is surrounded by a mathematical surface called event horizon, within which the escape velocity for a particle exceeds the speed of light to make the escape impossible. Since the mass of a black hole can only increase, the area A of the event horizon also increases. A has been associated by Hawking and Bekenstein by the equation. This is the equation relating the entropy, and here is the detail of the parameter. Now, something saying about the black hole. In generalized condition, the second law of thermodynamics states that as the sum of usual entropy of matter in the universe plus that of the black hole never decreases. Inside the black hole, the entropy what is the entropy measures the uncertainty of its internal configuration. We cannot tell if a black hole is formed from the collapse of a neutron star or a normal star or some other giant cosmic body. Only the mass, charge and its angular momentum of a black hole can be measured. In its past history or the present composition is totally hidden from us. Then entropy is related to life. How it is related? We receive a huge amount of energy from sun, mostly as UV or visible photon corresponding to the temperature of the solar surface. But the earth also ultimately radiates it back as infrared photons corresponding to the temperature of its atmosphere. Otherwise, the earth would have been warmer and warmer, and to keep its thermal condition nearly time independent, the total solar energy received must balance the total energy leaving the earth. Now, an UV or visible photon has higher frequency and hence more energy than an infrared photon. So photons that arrive are fewer than those that leave, but the entropy per photon is constant independent of the frequency. Thus, the incoming energy is low entropy energy and the outgoing one is higher entropy. This has been beneficial to our planet. In digesting food and building new cells and tissues, we extract some low entropy energy from plants and animal matter we eat, all derived from the sun. The evolution 1 million of years and associated complexity of life is driven by low entropy solar energy influx. Now the ultimate topic is the unavailable energy and thermal death of universe. We have seen in the previous equation that unavailable energy is related to this equation E is equal to T0 delta S, where T0 is the lowest possible temperature. From this, we may conclude that energy that is not available for work during an irreversible process increases the entropy of the universe. Since all natural processes are irreversible, energy available for work is continuously decreasing and entropy of the universe is filling up. You may now ask, how long will entropy continue to increase and what is the future of the natural world? We expect that ultimately it will reach some upper limit, and the principle of increase of entropy implies that universe is marching towards a stagnant thermal state to suffer thermal death. In the picture, you can see that in upper state, there is an ordered form of energy where the stars are visible and galaxies are visible. In the lower state, there is nothing actually. Heat death of universe is leading us to this type of state. We will get no information, nothing at all. There will be no energy to work, to do some work. Sure. All is going to be very unordered state. Now I am ending this by a famous statement by Arthur Eddington, and he is so convinced by the second law of thermodynamics that he told, if your theory is found to be against the second law of thermodynamics, I give you no hope. So this is my discussion. If anyone have any question, please let me know. I will answer as per my knowledge.
Okay, thank you. Thanks a lot, Srijan. It was a very nice and informative presentation. You have one question already from Devosmith, that if we achieve the formula of or process of reversing the entropy, then can we see the backward run in slow of time? This process we can see in the sci-fi movie Tenet, directed by Christopher Nolan, by using a turnstile. But in real life, is it possible? That is the question of Devosmith. Srijan?
I am reading the question. I don't think we can achieve something, that some device that will reverse the entropy. It is not possible at all. We have already proved that in all irreversible process, entropy always increases, universal entropy. If we it is possible to decrease the entropy of a system, the total entropy of universe always increases.
Right.
On the other hand, should I make any comment?
Yes, sir, please.
On the other hand, when you devise any experiment to decrease the entropy, that process should not be a natural process. It should not be a natural process. The principle of increase of entropy tells us that in all natural processes, entropy should increase.
Yes.
Right? But when you devise such an experiment or procedure that you can decrease, that process should not be a natural process.
Yes. Okay. When all energy is going to be at an another form highly, then we don't know actually what happened, but again a Big Bang can happen. Universe can again start its time. Somehow the all this energy will attain again a ordered form, and then again will undergo its cycle.
Okay, fine.
Thank you, Srijan. In fact, thanks to all our participants. Okay, we had a really nice interactive session with the students. Actually, it was a pleasure to be a part of this meeting, and the brilliant presentations by students truly left me speechless sometimes. I also happily express my joy in being with my fellow friends, like learned colleagues, company. And now it's time for convey the vote of thanks. I convey my sincere thanks to our principal, sir. My heartfelt thanks goes also to our HOD, sir, and all other faculty members of physics department. Also, I extend my thanks to the speakers of our semester 6. And last but not the least, I express my thanks to the student audience who were there till the end to encourage us to continue with this online seminar. Hope all of us will leave the meeting with lots of spellboundness in our mind, and we will remember their beautiful presentations forever. We will try to arrange other seminars also, students seminars for semester 4 students or semester 2 students, and we will notify you in due time, due course. Okay, so that is all for today's seminar meeting. Again, thanks to all of you for joining.